Have you ever heard people talk about how things used to be cheaper when they were younger?
Don't poo-poo a nickel, Lisa. A nickel will buy you a steak and kidney pie, a cup of coffee, a slice of cheesecake, and a newsreel, with enough change left over to ride the trolley from Battery Park to the Polo Grounds.
This is not a matter of faulty memory. It's an economic reality. The costs of goods and services tends to increase over time. It takes quite a bit of knowledge of economics to really understand the forces that cause this to happen, so we won't get into the why of inflation. However, we can talk about various features of it. One way that inflation is measured is through the Consumer Price Index, or CPI. The most intuitive way to understand this is that the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics creates a list of goods and services that the average consumer purchases, and then measures how much it would cost to make those purchases. This list is called the CPI Market Basket, and you can imagine the CPI as measuring how much you spend at checkout to buy that basket of goods. It's actually a very detailed calculation that involves consumer surveys and complex mathematical models, and while there's a lot of interesting mathematics involved, they are not important for this course. What is important is how we can use the CPI to interpret inflation. The CPI uses the years 1982 to 1984 as the base for the calculation and sets this value to be 100. The CPI is calculated monthly. In January 2018, the CPI was 247.867. What this means is that if the CPI market basket would have cost $100 in the early 1980s, the exact same basket would cost $247 in 2018. In other words, you can buy less than half of what you used to be able to buy for the same amount of money. Because the value of the dollar is changing, when making these comparisons, we need to specify which dollars we're using. In the previous example, we would say that the basket costs $100 in 1982 dollars and $247 in 2018 dollars. The CPI can be used to estimate the value of money at different times by setting up a simple proportion. For example, suppose you won a $5,000 prize in January 1989. What is the equivalent to that prize in January 2012? The CPI was 121.1 in January 1989 and 226.665 in January 2012. The prize was measured in 1989 dollars. By solving for the remaining variable, we can see that the equivalent amount of money in 2012 is $9,358.59. Fortunately, the change of the value of money usually happens very slowly, so that you do not feel the impact on a daily basis. There's no real difference in spending your money today and spending your money tomorrow. But what if that didn't happen? Imagine if you went to the store and a gallon of milk cost $2, but it only cost $1 yesterday. And tomorrow, the cost is expected to rise to $5. Although this may sound absurd, this has actually happened many times in history. This is known as hyperinflation. How does this happen? One way it happens is if a government prints a whole lot of money all at once. Pretend you live in a small, isolated town, and everyone in that town suddenly won a $1 billion lottery. What do you think is going to happen? Initially, everything is extremely cheap. A $1 million home is suddenly very cheap. You can afford lots of them. How do you think this will impact the price of the house? Sellers will no longer accept $1 million for the home because they know they can sell it for much more. This is basically what happens with hyperinflation. Because there's suddenly a lot more money, people and companies will raise their prices rapidly in order to get the most value they can for their goods and services. Eventually, if this goes unchecked, the currency collapses because it's not really worth anything anymore. In class, we're going to look at the impact of inflation on savings and investments.